we have heard, we are hearing the scripture passages as well as seeing them acted out, and they have been very impactful. And thank you so much to all who have participated in those. At MCC, we're always a little bit different than other churches, and we're looking at the gospel stories as told by the different gospel writers. We started off with wilderness stories. We looked at Jesus' time in the wilderness from the perspective of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Then we had action stories. We looked at Jesus' prophetic action against the temple from the perspective of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Today's theme of sinner stories focuses on a story found in just two gospels. That was Matthew and Luke. And the point of focusing on the same story as told by different gospel writers is to recognize that the good news has multiple sources, multiple interpretations, multiple impacts. Multiplicity is not something to avoid. It is something to celebrate. God's word, indeed, does not return void. And the fullness and abundance of God's word may be a little overwhelming from time to time, but God thinks that we can handle it. Now, there's an image today of being lost in Luke's gospel, an image of being astray in Matthew's gospel. And so we're going to start by focusing on this idea of lostness or being astray. Then we're going to look at the passages from Matthew and Luke from a wider perspective. And we're going to end with what the Holy Spirit might be telling the church through these scripture passages. Now, when we are physically lost, we are disoriented. And when we're spiritually lost, when we're morally lost, we are also disoriented. Now, when I first moved to the Lehigh Valley, I got lost all of the time. And this was devastating to me because I was not a person who got lost very often in my previous location, but I was used to a grid system for roadways, right? Amen? Yes. Yes. And I've lived in big cities, I've lived in small towns, but I had never lived in a place with a 5-point intersection. 5 points in South Bethlehem. Now, someone advised to use GPS, though I use GPS very rarely because I don't like the idea of a corporation knowing my whereabouts. And that's also why I rarely use location services on my phone. I'm not on the run from the CIA. But I am cautious about sharing information. There are always trade-offs for convenience. And one of the things I think we've given up most in the past few decades is our right to privacy. Technological advances are great, but they would be even greater if they would come accompanied by robust privacy protections. Now, but because of something like GPS, we are getting physically lost a lot less frequently. A pleasant voice tells us that there is a turn, and we prepare appropriately. Or the GPS helps us to avoid a traffic jam and take a faster route. And so while we're not physically lost as much, our information has become lost. Data brokers on the internet love trading our information, and targeted ads online have almost come to a point where they seem to read our minds. But while we may be a data point to numerous corporations, our information, remember this, our information is precious to God, and God holds it in the strictest of confidence and would never shame us with our information or try to sell us something. But God knows how we've gone astray, both online and offline. God loves us. In some ways, it seems like we are more likely these days to get lost online than we are to get lost on the roads. We can get on the internet and get lost pretty quickly in Wikipedia, looking up the actor who was on that show in the 1980s and wonder where he is now. And oh, we can click another link, which will take us to another show, and oh, here's another link, and here's another link, and we look at the clock, and it is an hour later. And have you ever noticed that lost time is often more painful than being lost on a drive? Well, these gospel stories today are about redeeming our lostness. Redeeming our lostness, bringing us back to clarity, to safety, to security in the Lord. What Jesus is getting at with his story is the redemption of being spiritually or morally lost. Those times when we are living away from God and we need the shepherd to bring us back to community. To be lost or to be astray from God is to be in a world of our own choosing, and it is absolutely marvelous at first. At first. We're doing whatever we want to do. We don't need God. We don't need any of God's people to offer us guidance or direction. There's no need to consult God for anything. No need to pray. The Bible is unnecessary. Jesus is a nice dude, but not a savior, and we've got it all under control. It's beautiful at the start to be in a world of our own choosing. People have stopped nagging us to do spiritual things, and we are in charge of our time. We have parted ways with God. We have separated ourselves from God. And again, it feels great at the beginning. But remember the definition of sin. Sin is separation from God. It's going our own way. It's making life about us rather than making our lives about God. As Paul points out in his letter to the Romans, we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. Now, as an important aside here, for too long, the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender community has avoided use of the word sin, and for good reason, right? Because LGBT people have been accused of sin for something that is definitely not a sin. For the millionth time, being LGBT is not a sin. Amen?
Amen.
And being a practicing LGBT person is not a sin. Amen?
Amen.
LGBT people were wonderfully made by God. Don't need to change anything about being LGBT. Being LGBT is not at all about being separated from God. And probably many LGBT people will say that when they came out, they felt quite close to God. So that being established, then what are some ways that we separate ourselves from God? There's a mighty long list. For instance, something like gossip is a sin. It's separating ourselves from God by putting people down as if we are capable of standing in judgment. Lying is a sin. Cheating is a sin. Again, there's a long, long list. Sin is something every follower of Jesus must contend with in order to grow in faith. I'm still surprised by how many people believe themselves to be without sin. There are a whole lot of Christians who could quite easily serve as modern-day Pharisees and scribes.
Yes.
Now, when Jesus says in Luke's Gospel, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance, he is speaking ironically about the 99 righteous folks. Just like everyone else, the scribes and the Pharisees are in desperate need of repentance. And most of all, they need to repent from their sense of spiritual superiority. Jesus loved sinners. Jesus loved people who recognized that they were sinners. In Luke's gospel story, it starts off boldly with that sentence. Now, all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus. Sinners want to listen to Jesus. Self-righteous folks are not interested in what Jesus had to say. And in fact, they are appalled with Jesus' outreach. So there's something wrong with us, and it's not about being LGBT. It's not about our fabulous personalities. There's something wrong with us in this, that we're attracted to sin. And the solution doesn't come in the form of self-help. We don't take a series of 5 classes on how not to gossip and then we are cured. Instead, the solution is God's help. We give ourselves to God. We surrender our lives and our thoughts and our words to God, who directs us in how to live and how to think and how to speak. We will fall short. And it is okay because we have faith that God is making it better, making us better. And most of all, we start a practice of repentance, which is an essential practice for any follower of Jesus. And repentance is simply returning to God. We fall away from God, we return to God. We fall away from God, we return to God. Making a commitment to repentance is making a commitment to healing the separation between ourselves and God. And repentance is often a focus during the Lenten season. Now, the very first thesis of Martin Luther's famous 95 Theses, which kicked off the Protestant Reformation in 1517, Martin Luther's very first thesis stated that the entire life of believers should be one of repentance. I'm going to say that again, his first thesis. The entire life of believers should be one of repentance. Now, while Luther establishes the theological importance of repentance, the great 20th century theologian Karl Barth, he points out that repenting is primarily a work of the mind. A work of the mind. Barth writes this. Metanoian, that's the Greek verb for repent. Metanoian is to reverse one's thinking, to think afresh,
to think through to God and God's kingdom.
Civil rights leader Martin Luther King, he called the nation to repent of its racism. King wrote this, and it may well be that we will have to repent in this generation, not merely for the vitriolic words and the violent actions of the bad people, but for the appalling silence and indifference of the good people who sit around and say, wait on time. There's a contemporary theologian. Her name is Sally McFay, and she wrote a book, Models of God. And she also brings up the idea of repenting of silence. And Sally McFay writes this, we do not need so much to accept Christ's sacrifice for our sins as we need to repent of a major sin, our silent complicity in the impoverishment of others and the degradation of the planet. So you see, both Martin Luther King and Sally McFay connect separation from God with separation from our neighbors who may be of a different race or ethnicity or economic class. And Sally McFay also connects returning to God with a restoration of the earth. Repentance is not just between an individual and God. Repentance is also an activity we may do together as a community. To be silent about discrimination or bigotry or inequality or a corporation dumping waste into a local river, to be silent about these things is to be okay with these things. God does not call people to be silent, but gives us the words. Paul writes to Timothy in the first chapter of his second letter, for God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and self-discipline. So we repent. We repent of our silence. And in that repentance, we return to God, become closer to God, who gives us the stamina and the energy to speak out for those who have no voice. Now in Luke's gospel, the sheep gets lost. In Matthew's gospel, the sheep goes astray. And the shepherd tracks it down. In the reading from Matthew's gospel, we hear at the start to take care to not despise one of these little ones. And little ones is likely a reference to newer, vulnerable church members. We at the beginning of a faith journey can be shaky sometimes. We may easily be led astray, but the shepherd finds the one sheep who has wandered off, and there's great rejoicing over the one who was found. Now, when I was in elementary school, my mother likes to remind me that one day I came home from classes and I declared, I am going to be a shepherd in a third world country. I like the idea of being a shepherd, hanging out with the sheep, guiding sheep up and down dusty roads, being in a place unlike anything I had experienced. Now, those who have been around shepherds assure me that they are a very rough bunch, actually, and that people become shepherds mostly because they do not interact well with people. Need to check on my calling again. In Old Testament times, shepherds were often viewed positively. We can think of several Old Testament passages, right, that speak to this. Psalm 23, one we most recognize, the Lord is my shepherd. Shall not want. Psalm 78, then God led out God's people like sheep and guided them in the wilderness like a flock. Isaiah 40, so beautiful. God will feed God's flock like a shepherd. God will gather the lambs in God's arms. Ezekiel 34, for thus says the Lord God, I myself will search for the sheep and will seek them out. As shepherds seek out their flocks when they are among their scattered sheep, so I will seek out my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places to which they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. Now, the shepherd metaphor throughout the Hebrew Bible was interpreted by the community of Israel to mean that God would protect the Israelites. God would seek them out when they were lost. Now, in Jesus' day, people no longer held a very high regard for shepherds. Shepherding was a lonely job. It was frequently dangerous. People with better options would gravitate to other work. The hours were 24/7. And the shepherd would need to keep the flock safe from wild animals and thieves. And from a business perspective, seeking out the one lost sheep was not a wise move on the shepherd's part. The core of the business, right, the 99 sheep were intact. And the shepherd was leaving the 99 unprotected in the wilderness to track down the one lost sheep. stories and in his parables, people do not act in ways that are reasonable and practical. The shepherd makes a risky move to track down the one that has gone astray. It is risky. It is risky to call someone back to God. Sometimes when we are in the role of shepherd and we call the one sheep back to God, that one sheep may insist that they are fine and they're not interested in returning. Sometimes the one sheep may be offended that we have reached out and they tell us that we are the problem. The one sheep may have joined another flock. The one sheep may want us to call them back, but they keep going on their own path, and while they appreciate the call, they're going in another direction. It's risky to call someone back to God. God took a risk with all of us. Again and again, God calls us back to God. Again and again, God risks our rejection. Yet God continues to reach out to us when we are lost, when we are astray, because we are of great value to God. In the Roman Catholic Church, there is a beautiful song. It's titled, Come Back to Me. God calls out to the person who is lost. Come back to me with all your heart. Don't let fear keep us apart. Long have I waited for your coming home to me and living deeply our new life. So God shepherds us, and we are called on to shepherd others. Parents shepherd their children, bring them back to God. Friends shepherd their friends. When they go astray, we lead them back to God. Church members shepherd fellow church members. The loss of just one sheep breaks the shepherd's heart and breaks the church's heart. Anyone who is a member of any church knows that faith communities experience the loss of precious sheep. And it is painful. Precious people pass away. And while we praise God that there is a thin veil between life and death, the person is no longer in our earthly lives in the same way. Precious people, they move to new homes or new cities. They're no longer able to attend worship. Precious people did not connect with the worship style or the programming or the congregation, commit to another flock. And then there are the precious people who are no longer interested in a faith life. Precious sheep are lost or go astray, and again, it is painful. Yet today's gospel readings are not about loss. They're about rescue. The one sheep is saved. And not at the expense of the other 99 sheep, but to rejoin the community. While there is time for mourning losses and grieving over the lost sheep in any church, today is a time for joy. The one sheep has returned. And Jesus says that when we find the lost sheep, we can call together friends and neighbors. And we say to those friends and neighbors, rejoice with me. Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost. God throws a party for us when we return to God. Repentance is nothing to be afraid of. Repentance leads to rejoicing. And so we are invited to throw a party for others when they repent and return to God. Oh wait, we kind of already do that every Sunday, don't we? Every Sunday is an opportunity to repent and return to God. We return to God through worship, and the party continues every Sunday afterwards with a coffee hour. There's a Baptist pastor, his name is Kyle Ray Rothaus, and he shares these words. Pastor Kendall. Imagine my relief later in life when I finally learned that repentance wasn't about feeling guilty for your sins. Repentance was about transformation and growth, about turning away from distractions and toward what is good. Repentance wasn't fueled by shame, it was fueled by a promise of a party. As the scriptures tell us, it is God's kindness that leads to repentance. And so we are called on to dance for joy when one sheep returns home. We are called to shout for joy when someone who has been away from God returns to God. There's no time for wagging a finger at a person who has gone astray and has returned. It's time for a warm embrace. For the one who was lost has been found. The one who has been astray has repented. It is time for a party. So every Sunday is a repentance party, an opportunity to return to God. We can go to 52 repentance parties in a year. Wow. The Holy Spirit is calling the church to to host a weekly repentance party, calling all sinners home, and that's all of us. Praise God for a weekly party. The lost sheep have arrived home. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for seeking us out, searching us out. Thank you, God, for bringing us back home. And sometimes you even carry us back home. We are grateful for your love, your care, your steadfastness, your patience. Because, Lord, again and again and again, you've called us to return to you. And again and again and again, we've told you to talk to the hand. And yet you keep calling us back to you. And we fall into your arms today. And we trust that you've got us. We trust that you are holding on to us and are never going to let us go. Thank you for your great love. Thank you for your shepherding. Help us to shepherd the people in our lives, friends, family, church members, co-workers, community. Help us, O Lord. Give us the words and the confidence to call your people back home. It's an honor to shepherd, for we have been shepherded. Bless us all, we pray.